Till last class, we have seen the techniques of identity theft. But today, we are going to learn about the measurements to be taken against identity theft. So, identity theft is a severe kind of thing happens every day due to ignorance, lack of awareness, lack of security in softwares, etc. and so on. Several reasons are there to give up our credentials over the internet. Now, by following some of the steps, we can protect ourselves from the stealing of identity. So, how to prevent being victim of identity theft? So, monitor your credit closely. So, monitor your credit closely means if you are going for ATM, withdraw, transfer or deposit, keep the slip instead of throwing away the bank receipts, ATM machine receipts, keep it in the pocket and keep it in for few days in the safe lock. So don't throw away, otherwise you will be end up with a dumpster diving attack. If you keep throw there itself in the dustbin of that ATM machine, there is a possibility of recovering from that. That's why don't keep throw away in the dustbin. So if you do that, dumpster diving attack will happen. So if you purchase anything online, monitor your account activity. The intended product cost, whether it is debited or it includes the delivery charges or not. Check the frequently your account statements, monitor it closely. If a small amount of money, if it is debiting, means immediately contact, without your knowledge, immediately contact to the nearest banks about the transaction it has happened. So there's another way of preventing being a victim of identity theft. The second way is keep records of your financial data and transactions at least for 3 months. So every transaction what you made, either online or offline, keep track of the financial data and the transactions. By then and then obtain the passbook printouts, then and then take a download the statement of accounts, collect the receipts which you are paying for petrol bills, electrical bills, any bill payment if you do, you keep those records. So once after a few days, if you look into your bank account, if a suspicious transaction was happened, means you cannot do anything later stage. That's why keep an eye of your bank statements. Install security software. It is one challenging for us because many of us, we are having the mid-performed laptops or the desktop. The RAM capacity is 8 to 16 GB, not more than that. So installing every patches, installing every OS patches, security antivirus, anti-spyware, anti-malware, anti-phishing, anti-identity theft. So installing every security into our system, the system performance may come down. Although to protect yourself from the hackers, you need to do that one, install security softwares. So then use an updated web browser, then and then updates will be released by the web browsers. You keep update whenever they release the updates. Before updating, look into the update content. What is the thing is updating? Whether they are updating the bugs which are identified or vulnerability which are exist with the existing browser, or totally they are changing from the version to version. Before updating, you keep an eye of updating content. Otherwise, so if false updation happens, then the plugin is going to insert onto your browser, the plugin might be a keylogger, or plugin might be a spyware that keeps an eye on your browser. It records everything. So be careful about the updating softwares when you are installing onto your system or the browsers. Be way of email attachments. Even though if it is coming from intended user or the source, you need to be look the attachment think twice before downloading or clicking on the attachments. And if any email links which is comes within the email browser, within the email inbox, before clicking that link, follow the flowchart which I was given for phishing, how to identify it is a spoofed email or it is a phished email. So check the attachment, it is coming from known. If it is no, don't open it. If it is known, check whether that attachment having any executable file or not. If yes, don't click on that one. Ask the source of trust of that attachment. If there is no .exe or some other files than the executable file, then check whether it is coming from the source again. So these are the flowchart you need to follow whether you want to download it or not. Decide to download it or not. Store sensitive data securely. How we are keeping our the money, jewels, etc. In any other the asset papers, all other documents, how we are keeping safely under the lock. In the same way, your identity, your credentials, your digital documents, you need to be taken care to save them. You keep under the security locks. Shred documents, you need to be carefully tear out the documents which are not used. As I said, you keep at least 3 months bank statement. So after 3 months, you are going to throw. If you are going to throw also, the people who is obtaining that the dumpster, they are going to take some of the information from that. That's why be careful before destroying the document. You tear up, even though if they are going to reassemble that destroyed, they should not get any personal identity of you. You must be careful while tearing the documents. So protect your PII, protect your personally identifiable information. That is most important, because giving up, already we have given a lot of personally identifiable information over the internet. At least after knowing and having awareness of importance of sensitive PII, at least now onwards you stop uploading the content of yours everywhere, wherever you feel comfortable, right? So because you will be the victim of the identity theft and phishing attacks, so stay alert to the latest scams. So then and they then subscribe some of the web some of the websites or the TV channels or the newsletters or the publications. Keep monitoring the scams are happening in and around your places and your state or the country. So by knowing them, the scams, then you will be in a precautious mode of not sharing the personal information over the internet. These are the some of the measures need to be taken against the identity theft. So before going to be a victim of somebody or the hacker, you must be very careful. So how to protect? Yes, some of the measurements were taken. Now how to protect or face your online identity? Completely, if you want to remove your online identity, some of the website and tools are available over the internet. With the help of these tools, you can remove most of your personal identifiable information which is already shared over the internet. For example, some of the tools are here, Giant Matrix, Privacy Eraser, Reputation Defender, then Reputation Defender, then Suicide Machine, and Seppuku. These are the some of the online identity tools are used to erase the online identity of you, which is already shared before knowing the before knowing and having the awareness of identity of sharing personal. Now, after knowing that, you can make use of one of these tools to remove your identity from the social media accounts. If you already shared, if you don't want to now onwards, if you don't want to maintain or if you don't want to share in the social account, you can use the one of the tools to protect your identity. Giant Matrix, what it is going to do, it is going to anti-tracks. These are Giant Matrix are the tools, set of tools that appear to be a complete to protect your online identity. Sensitive data and maintaining the integrity of your system by hiding system's IP address. Securely locking and hiding important files and folders. And maintaining a healthy system performance, which keeps the system in top-notch condition. Some of the tools which are available with the giantmatrix.com, some of the website, if you look, so depending on your preference, you can download some of the tool and you can made your sensitive data safe and you can protect yourself. The another tool is Privacy Eraser. It protects internet privacy by cleaning up all the tracks of internet and computer activities and supports almost all popular web browsers. If you use the web browser, if you are not cleared the web browsers then and then, you can make use of the history of the web browsers. So hackers will not only look into the content of which you are going to use currently, they are going to look back the website which you browsed or surfed, the items which you brought so from of the e-commercial website, all the history records, they are going to track you. So based on that, they will create a profile of you and target you as a victim. So Privacy Eraser is such kind of the tool. It protects the internet privacy by cleaning up all the tracks of internet and computer activities and supports almost all popular web browsers. So reputationdefender.com is another website which provides the My Privacy software. It removes your personal information such as name, address, age, phone, past address and any other related information. It also helps by continuously monitoring the internet to remove the footprint available on the internet. See, you can, till now we thought of how to delete our personal content which is already shared over the internet. Now there is a set of tools are available to clean up your already shared information over the internet from the internet servers. The another tool which is available is the suicidemachine.org. So what it is going to do is, it is clearing the servers of social networking websites. It completely roots out your identity from the servers of social networking websites such as MySpace. MySpace is like similar to the Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, etc. Suppose one will have to reveal the login credentials, but for this application, the one thing you need to give up is you need to provide your login credential to access your account. So if you allow this allowing, how to believe this tool, how to believe this tool, again it is a challenging one. It is up to you whether you are believing or not. It depends on you. If believing, use it, otherwise don't use it. One will have to reveal the login credentials for the corresponding web applications to use this tool. If he does not, or he or she does not need them anymore, then he can let suicide machine eradicate the details from these web apps. So if any web apps which you are using, like Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, MySpace, Instagram, any social engineering networking website which you, if you shared any many more information, so then you can stop. If you don't want to continue with them, if you can continue with them, if you don't want to disclose your personal identifiable information over the internet, in that case you can make use of suicide machine application, give some of the permissions to allow to clean up your accounts. The one more tool is called as seppuku.com. Seppuku.com is a Japanese word. It is coming from seppuku, ritual suicide. It is ancient Japanese samurai warriors. It was used. It is an anti-social network failing to destroy your identity, specifically the footprint on the Facebook. So specifically, because one or the other way we are connected with the Facebook. So whether we are drinking the water or tea in the morning from the bed, usually we start watching the Facebook from the mobile phone, right? Suppose you don't want to be in the Facebook, if you want to clear the tracks of the content of yours from the Facebook, you can try out this application, seppuku.com. This website is operated by a group that calls itself Lins Invisibles, that is imaginary art group from Italy. Okay, so these are the some of the tools. Many tools are available over the internet. If you surf it, the Google it, many tools are available to protect from the identity theft. So the importance of identity theft, which is explaining through this slide, you can look into the slide of this. Is it visible properly? Students, are you there? Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Is it visible?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
See, the cat is sitting in front of the system and it uses the internet services. At the other end, nobody will come to know that whether the cat is sitting or the human is sitting or robo is sitting. Yes, sir, how you come to know whether which person is sitting in front of system over the internet? It may be the automated programming machine is sitting, automation is automated robotic sitting, any animal is sitting or human being is sitting. On the internet, nobody knows you are a cat, because until unless if you give up your credential, then people will come to know that you are on the internet. If you are not give up your credential or submitting your credentials to any of the accounts, then they will not come to know who you are. That is, anonymity breeds crime, stranger is danger. On the internet, it does not matter who you are as long as you have ID. So identity is most important when you are sitting on the internet. If you give up unnecessarily, if you give up the information, you will be the victim of identity attack. And in turn, it leads to a financial gain for the hackers. You are going to lose the financial, etc. Okay. Any questions are there with respect to the phishing and the identity theft? Elaborately, in detail, I was done the discussion of phishing and identity theft. Still, if any questions or doubts are there from your end, you can ask me. Any questions? No questions. If no questions, I will move forward. If any questions, I am waiting for your questions.
Sir, I have a thing, sir. Sir, you have given some assignment, sir, in the GCR.
Yes.
Any details about, sir, the some assignment to get some information, something like that.
Assignment related, I will discuss after this class hour, means end of the class. Okay, that is self-explanatory assignment content is there in that. So still, if you have any doubt in that, I will discuss at the last part of this class. Any questions relevant to the phishing attacks and the identity theft, you can ask me. Okay, Kishan. If no questions, I'll move to the next topic. That is digital forensic. I hope I made you understand about phishing attacks, precautions, measures, tools, types of phishing, methods of phishing, techniques of phishing, categories of phishing, identity, what is PII, what is HIPAA, categories of identity, techniques of identity, methods of identity, tools used for identity prevention, right? Yes, sir. The 58 plus 4, another 4 students are there extra today. Extra students are there. Total 60, 53, yeah? Fine. Okay. Let's go on to discussion on digital forensic science. This is very interesting, very interesting, very interesting. Digital forensic science is a science, it is an art of collecting, analyzing, predicting, preparing the digital data from the place of crime happened. So digital forensic, also termed as alternatively, most of the time digital forensic, that term is used as cyber forensics. Also, it is also called as computer forensic science. Digital forensic science, cyber forensic science, or it is also called as computer forensic science. What is digital forensics? It is a huge topic. It is a huge, one of the huge topic of discussion. But according to your syllabus, only 2 to 3 subtitles are given. Since it requires the exclusively 2 hours to discuss that one. Tomorrow, 3rd and 4th hour, I'm going to engage to discuss in detail about digital forensic. Now I am introducing what is digital forensic. So it is a branch of forensic science. So what is forensics? Evidence. Evidence is collecting where the crime has happened. If crime happened from computer or to target computer, it is termed to be as a digital forensic. Probably you heard about the forensic labs. What they are going to do in the forensic lab? They are going to encompassing the recovery if any digital devices they found at the place of crime. They are collecting all the evidences, including mobile phone, USB drives, pen drive, CD-ROM, CDs, computers, personal laptops, CC cameras, any audio recorders, any video recorders found in place of crime. So they are going to recover and they are going to investigation of material found in digital devices. Often in relation to computer crime, so digital forensic investigations have a variety of applications. So the one application which is used to recover the digital prints which is happening with the laptop of one computer, one model might be different from another model. Let us go with, suppose, Windows system which uses a set of the forensic tools to recover the data which has been deleted by the criminals, right? So recovering tools are available, reconstructing of recovered tools are available, many kind of tools are available depending on the application type which is used by the crimes or criminals or the victim. So for mobile application, mobile related tools are available for forensic. For the printer, printer is also comes under the evidence of the digital printer is also a evidence of forensic. So for printers, recover softwares are different, recovering applications are different. For the personal digital assistants like iPod, iPad, different set of applications are needed. For Linux operating system machines, different tools are available. For Mac OS machines, different tools. Android machines, different tools. So depending on the operating system type, the device which uses, model it uses, and the hardware, the configuration, depending on that, several variety of investigations tools are available with the digital forensic labs. So cyber forensics plays a key role in investigation of cyber crime. Evidence in the case of cyber offenses is extremely important from legal perspective. If some crime is happened through phone, mobile phone, so to nowadays policemen depend on the mobile phones. They are easily finding the offenses within 24 hours. If any murder happened, any chase snatching happened, if any kind of crime happened like drug spreading, such kind of the activities, they are first there. Once they visit the crime place where it is happened, immediately they collect the evidences, criminals, mobile phone, laptops or any devices which they used for to commit the crime. So through that, they are going to submit the recovered devices to the forensic lab. Forensic lab is going to recover the digital data. Even though if it is deleted by them, they are recovering from the tools which are highly sophisticated tools are available to recover the deleted data from the memory. Until unless if physical hardware, if it is not damaged, then they can able to recover the data. If it is damaged, for them it is little difficult because tracks of recording tracks, if it is corrupted, the reading tracks, if it is corrupted, it is difficult to recover such kind of the magnetic tapes. So note, only the technical trained and experienced experts should be involved in the forensic activities. It is true. Why trained and experienced experts are needed? Students, please answer. Why trained and experienced experts are needed for forensic activities?
So for the correctness.
Correctness for decisions, right? You are right. So previous to that, why it is needed?
To crack the crime.
So whichever the devices, if they were recovered from the criminals, they should be carefully handle such devices. For mishandling, if any mishandling happen by the newbie who is the member of the team of expert, there is a chances of losing the main evidence, which main evidence has happened for that crime. If mishandling, because the newbie of forensic, they does not know how to handle the sensitive devices or sensitive recovered digital information. If they are unable to know, even though if it is trained, so trained is different from experienced. Experience based on the real-time experience from long years, they came to know that how to handle the evidences, digital evidences they have collected from the criminal spots. Whereas trainers, only they know about the technicality of the devices or recovery tools. They don't know how physically they should handle them. So that's why the need. So usually forensic team, which will consist of the technically trained and experienced experts, peoples are involved, rather than the newbie like you or me, like average users or the average knowledge oriented persons. Okay, is it clear why it is technically and experienced people is needed? If any mishandling of such device, there is a chance of losing are losing the main evidences which is recovered from the criminal spot. That's the reason. And if we look into the from where it was started, cyber forensic was this branch of science, when it is started, what was the reason of beginning of that forensic? Because for every branch of science, there was a begun of some reasons. So similar to that, cyber forensics, as there was a reason in the year 1970, during that time when the computer was came into existence, when the computers are interconnected within the university campus, during when the students started protesting and burned some of the computers from the universities, then at the same time some of the group of people, they are trying to penetrate into the system without the permission, that is unauthorized access, they want to target to the shared computers. At the same time students are protesting, some group are protesting and burning the computers, physically burning the computers. Some group of people, they are trying to attack the system without having the permissions, that is unauthorized access. During that time, this cyber forensics came into existence. So the police started thinking of how to recover the information which is burned out from the fires. then they will start thinking about the forensic, digital forensic or computer forensic or cyber forensic. So the with the help of the computers was the first crimes to be widely recognized as a new type of crime. So new type of crime previous to the cyber crime, previous to that the manual crime was happening. So when they started destroying the digital assets like digital computer, the telecommunication lines, and the electrical hubs, if they start destroying that one, then that time the cyber criminals were the cyber crimes are identified as a new type of the crime. During 1978, Florida Computer Crimes Act was the first computer crime law. So there was a crime means obviously to control that crime, there is a law enforcement agencies, agencies frame the law to control the crime which is happened against the computers. So during the law to address computer fraud and intrusion. So intrusion is nothing but without permission of a intended user, if you are using any electronic devices, that is termed as an intrusion or penetration or unauthorized access. It was enacted in the Florida in 1978. During the 19th, so crime was happened almost 69 to 70. So after 10 years that down the line, the first law was framed against to protect the computer crimes. So the application of computer for investing computer-based crime has led to development of a new field called computer forensics. Some of the applications are developed to invest what for? To invest investing computer-based crime. If any person who has a malicious intent in his mind, then he is going to use if any electronic device. Previously, we don't have a much number of device. Previously, the computer and supercomputers were there. So nowadays, so many sorts of electronic devices. We can think of that. We instead of computer-based, it's an electronic-based device we can think of. Because IoT is also a one kind of the so emerging area where the it is needed. With the help of the drone cameras, if they are committing crime, that is also needed to be identify that device and recover the digital data which is present in that. So the application of computer for investigating, it is not investing, it is investigating, computer-based investigating. Computer-based crime has led to development of a new field called computer forensics. Alternatively, it is a digital forensic. It has exists for as long as people have stored data inside computers. Until the computer, the people are using the computer as a storage. People are using mobile as a storage. People are using drone as a storage. People are using the electronic device as a storage. Till that time, the digital forensic, this branch of forensic exists. This is some brief historical background of cyber forensics. For additional things, you can refer to our textbooks or Google. So please make a note of this slide, especially if you have pen and paper, better you jot down this one rather than taking screenshot. So the basically computer forensic experts need digital evidence. What is digital evidence in cases involving, which are the digital evidences, which are those? Data acquisition. Before destroying the physical device, what they are going to do, the computer forensic experts. Data acquisition means whichever the data, initial data at the time of the investigation time, any device, if they found first, they are going to recover that and they are going to collect the data which is available with that device. Then their preservation, they will do the preservation of the data in a careful way. They will keep that collected data in a safe place. Then recovery, if any damage happened to that hardware or physical device, they are going to use the recovery tools. There are so many recovery tools are there. So we will discuss those recovery tools in tomorrow session. So analysis and reporting. So once recovery, preservation, data is acquired, then analysis and reporting. They need to analyze the data. So mail data, communication data, WhatsApp data, Facebook data. So several datas which might be used by the crime hackers or the criminals, those it is going to be analyzed and reporting the same. And usually the forensic experts uses intellectual property theft. So intellectual property theft means it's like patents, trademarks, logos, or you are defaced one of the company name and you are using it as a phishing attack. Such kind of the things they are looking into. Computer misuse, any computer misuse has happened in the crime activity. Corporate policy violation, whether that employee who is working for the company or the organization, whether he or she has violated any policies set by the corporate, they are checking into that. Mobile device data acquisition, the personal devices, usually the mobile phones, also they are acquiring the data from the mobile phones and doing their analysis. If any malicious software or application installed with the device which is recovered, also they are checking. System intrusion and compromise, if any compromise channels they might used by the criminals, they are going to check into that also. If any data which is encrypted format, there is a chances of sensitive communication happened between two criminals over the globe and they made it as encrypted. So encrypted files are going to be required by the forensic experts. Deleted and hidden files recovery, they will do. Pornography, if any pornography kind of communication has happened between the child and the criminals, so that is also confidential information leakage, etc. These kind of the information they are going to recover from the devices by whom? The computer forensic experts. So these are all the possible threats happened with the crime, cyber crimes. So these are the things the cyber forensic experts are going to recover and analyze and present as a report to the law enforcement agency like the court. So there is a slight difference between computer security and versus computer forensic. See, as you are aware that so far we have seen cyber security. Cyber security is little different from computer forensic. Cyber security, which follows the CIA triad model, that is confidentiality, integrity, and the availability. So computer security or cyber security follows to protect the unauthorized access from the person. So to prevent or protect the unauthorized access to computer system is termed to be in terms of CIA triad model. Confidentiality, integrity, and availability of computer. That is termed to be a computer security. Whereas the computer forensic is such that computer forensics is the primary concerned with the systematic identification, acquisition, preservation and analysis of digital evidence. So computer security is CIA model, whereas the computer forensic is IAPA model, that is identification, identifying the identification is equal to identifying the objects which are found nearby the crime place, either it is a physical space or the logical space. Logical space is usually the computer on the internet or the cyberspace, whereas physical place is the physically object can be found near the crime committed spot. So physical places, for example, Elanka or BMSIT or the nearby Bangalore city, like that. That's a physical space. Whereas logical space is internet cyberspace. It might be anywhere in this globe, it is crime is happening logically. So identification, where the crime has happened, is very important. Identification, whether it is logical space or cyberspace or the physical space. Then acquisition, once the expert is able to identify where it has happened, then acquisition, which are the possible data, depending on the, if it is physical offense, then you are going to collect the knife which is used to nab the person, or any cloths, any ear tips fallen near, such kind of evidences they are collecting. In case of digital evidences, they are collecting the communication happened, phone to whom they have called before committing the crime. So history of the call records, the SMS message, WhatsApp message, Instagram, which they used, Twitter account, any social media account they used before committing crime. So all such data is going to be acquired, means collect from that digital evidences which is present over the internet. Then preservations, once identified it properly and done the acquisition, they're going to keep it safe, preserved till the necessary action will be initiated by the law force agencies, like court. Till that time, they are preserving the evidences which has been collected by them, and analysis. So after preservation, they are going to do the analysis about the collected data, about a crime which has happened, of digital evidence. IAPA is the model of the computer forensic, whereas computer security CIA model, confidentiality, integrity and availability, whereas cyber forensic, it is identification, I, A, acquisition, P, preservation, and the A is analysis. Identification, acquisition, preservation, and analysis of digital evidence. Typically, after an unauthorized access to computer or unauthorized use of computer has taken place, usually these kind of identification, acquisition, preservation, and analysis, these steps are happen only when any criminal activity being carried out by the criminals. Not always. Criminals might be unauthorized access, or might be a phishing attackers, or any kind of the criminal activity which is carrying out with the help of the computer. Computer as a committing tool, or computer might be a target tool, both. For both these cases, the computer forensics comes into the picture. The goal of computer forensics is to perform a structured investigation on a digital system. The goal of computer forensics is to perform structured investigation on a digital system. Investigation itself is one challenging job, since every small evidences also might contribute to tell about the crime or to reveal the crime which has happened. which is already happened. So investigation, if it is not structured, difficult to gather the information and analyze. So that's why the investigation should be very well structured manner. Then it is easy for the experts to come to the conclusion of forward that to a suitable law force agencies. Okay, this is about some of the definition of digital forensic science. Digital forensic science, some of the exercise, if you have a time, please go through with coffee time, tea time, and difference between forensic policy and security policy. So coffee time is, coffee is nothing but your computer online forensic evidence extractor, is a USB thumb drive gadget. So around 150 programs which are installed in the USB thumb drive. This USB thumb drive only which is available with the forensic experts. Forensic experts having some of the law force permissions to check the some other's computers, some other devices, some other browsers, they can check with the help of this coffee time. So it's an USB drive which is installed with the around 150 tools, cyber extraction tools, evidence extraction tools are available with the USB thumb drive. Usually this drive is not available with the common public or the common person like me or you. So the one more tool which is available is a tool, a total evidence analyzer, that is termed as a T-time total evidence analyzer analysis tool, is which again it is available with the cyber forensic departments. So difference between forensic policies and security policies, you please explore this. Policies is meant for to protect an organization from unauthorized access and use of the computer system and the premises. That is security policy. Forensic policy is that you explore that one, explore and come back to me for tomorrow's class. Okay. Any questions are there? Any questions are there? No. Thank you.